Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the European Challenger Scene qualifiers. My name is Munchables, and I'm joined once again by Sona and Excoundrel as we head into the fifth game of tonight. Now, it's going to be LDLC up against Babaski. So French versus the Polish. We'll see how this one's going to turn out. I mean, on paper, how does this one look to you guys?
LDLC, for me, have looked like the better squad. I think they've shown more like they are like the top teams in their groups as opposed to Babaski, who haven't really found their feet yet. Now, actually, someone did an infographic I saw on Reddit. They were doing an infographic, and actually, but they were saying about how many players from each nationality are currently in the EU Challenger Series qualifications. And actually, Poland have got 11 players across all
12,
teams.
12, I believe.
12, actually, I believe. Yeah. Across all teams, apparently, according to the rosters. So Babaski come from a region where they actually have the most competitive players in the EU Challenger scene in total. However, the actual team of Babaski seem to have struggled. However, this is probably one of the easier matchups I think they would have had over the last 2 days. So this could be their time to shine.
I think that's a really tough one to say, actually. I mean, like, Babaski played Euronics yesterday and Nerve the day before. Those are two really hard matchups, but in my opinion, I actually think LDLC are playing better than Euronics are. If you compare the way that Euronics played against Nerve earlier on today and the way that LDLC played against Fnatic Academy yesterday, although Fnatic Academy were a very strong team and won the game, LDLC showed more signs of life to me. They were making picks, making plays. They actually led in the early game as well. So I think this is probably the second hardest match that Bob's going to have to play.
Okay, so we're talking about LDLC and how
Bob's
they...
Bob's going to have to play, just sounds really odd. Babaski,
yeah, it's like a
play.
Person. But we're talking about LDLC, how they're on paper a stronger team. What is it about LDLC that makes them stronger? What is the deficit between these two squads? How can we quantify it?
I just want to see more coordination from LDLC when it comes to their bot lane. They've got a very strong bot lane with them. They've got Moops and
Crabby.
They've got
You're
Moops.
Thinking of dinner, Excoundrel.
I know. I smell the Chinese food from over there. They've got Moops and Crowny, who are two very, very solid players. I'd love to see that more coordination that Fnatic give their bot lane when they're coming to look to capitalize on that bot lane tier one. You know, take that away. That seems to be the key to a lot of these games that we've seen transpire over the last few days. Whoever takes that tier one tower in the bot lane immediately has the advantage in the game. So I'd like to see some more coordination coming from them.
I think, just going back to your question, like, looking at the difference between the two teams, a lot of it is LDLC actually utilizing advantages they get. So go back to day one when Babaski were playing up against, I want to say Nerve? Yeah, they're playing up against Nerve, and they had a 5-0 lead. Mattislaw got a double kill bot lane and a triple kill around Dragon. You really need to be using a Fed Orianna when you're getting into mid game. They didn't really push, they didn't really get any objectives off it, and it meant that we saw Nerve just getting straight back into the game and being able to dominate from about the 20 minute mark or so. LDLC, even against Fnatic Academy, were able to utilize their advantages and actually force Fnatic Academy to make good plays rather than just allowing them to play an average game and still win.
Okay, well, we'll see whether these teams can change things up, whether Babaski will be able to actually roll forward if they do get a lead. And we come back to that same conversation once again. This is another team that is 0-2 in the league so far. Another loss, and that will be a death sentence for them across this league. But here we go. Picks and bans underway. Thresh going to be the first ban, followed by Rengar.
Yeah, and also we've got to pay note that Ika has been really good for LDLC
Incredibly
in the mid lane.
Good, yeah.
I mean, Ika's been a fantastic player. As Afraid, I mean, I almost forgot to mention, I think everybody from LDLC have looked really solid on an individual level. Just need to sort of tie it together and make sure that they are focusing on that macro-orientated structure-based gameplay. We've seen that they can do it, you know, and this is one of the best times that they can show that they've got what it takes to beat teams that potentially could be considered potentially could be considered slightly lower level of opposition than the likes of Fnatic Academy and Nerve. And I think LDLC definitely have what it takes. Bans coming through here, some mid lane targeted, Ryze and Syndra. It might be one of the first games today that we don't actually see a Syndra in.
Yeah, and I think we're going to see an opportunity here for LDLC to decide what they get as a first pick, because Babaski, they have to ban Camille here. Surely
Absolutely.
They have to ban Camille here. And if not, that's very likely going to be the first pick.
Oh, definitely. I think you can't leave Camille on the cards. We've seen how badly that can play for you. If you have a Camille ban, you're probably looking at a jungle focus or maybe a top lane focus. Poppy still on the cards. Frey plays an incredible Poppy. So this is probably going to be a Poppy lock here. And then you'll see Babaski trying to take a strong support and then a good jungler as well.
Because Frey has been fantastic on Poppy. So I wouldn't be surprised to see that locked in early on, especially with the fact that Camille's now obviously gone. So there's no likelihood of Poppy really realistically facing many bad matchups in the top lane. You could also consider a jungler, like if you really want to get Gnara onto Rek'Sai. Karma being considered heavily. It's been a while since we've seen Karma prioritized this heavily by a team in this qualification tournament, but they do feel like it's something that Moops really wants.
We've seen a lot of Karma. We've seen a lot less Karma today, though.
Yes.
And we've definitely not seen it first pick today. This was like, at the very start of the tournament, the draft looked like Karma first pick pretty much every game, and we've seen less and less of it, as you say. It's going to be locked in by LDLC, though, still keeping their focus on similar champions.
If you look at the Thresh ban, there are a lot of good Thresh players amongst the supports here. Look at Noxiac, look at Klai. Mystique plays a good Thresh as well. I think you can see a sort of indication towards this Karma pick. However, I still think you could have led it through. Zyra's still there. She's still a very strong support. And Ashe Zyra is such a deadly bot lane to have to play into. Now that Babaski have got that Poppy in the top, it could just be LDLC saying, look, we have confidence in the Poppy, in our ability to counter the Poppy. But I really think Poppy as a first pick would have just given them another string to their bow.
Yeah, we've seen that the likes of Nautilus can be just as useful in a team composition. And you can see even here, Nautilus is being thought about by LDLC. Ashe coming in early on does surprise me, but it does mean that you don't get an Ashe Karma lane where you've got a really fantastic shove early on. So they take that away immediately. I think Olaf has only been played by Gnara so far. I believe he's the only jungler to have picked up Olaf thus far in the tournament, and he played it very, very well.
Yeah, and I think the key goal there with the Olaf pick is you see an Ashe on the enemy team, you're like, okay, this is a target I can lock down.
Definitely.
If she tries to ult defensively, don't care, Ragnarok. Just charge on forwards and try and finish off that AD carry ASAP. And also, I like the Nautilus pick into the Poppy. You know, it's just another tank that can go toe-to-toe. And as the game goes on, Nautilus starts to out-trade Poppy as well.
I think I think Poppy does sort of trade really well into Nautilus late game. Nautilus probably gives you a little bit more in team fights if he's there at the start because of his pick potential.
I've always said that Nautilus shoves Poppy early on.
Riptide just shoves the lane really easily.
Poppy can't trade with Nautilus earlier on because Riptide's such a good trading tool and you push those minion waves more readily. But as the game goes on, it just becomes a wet noodle fight.
Poppy doesn't really care.
Neither does Nautilus to an extent. Like, neither of them are really going to care that much. So Rek'Sai and Zyra come through here. Rek'Sai obviously is very high up on the tier list that we've talked about in terms of junglers, and Sona talked about the Zyra still being available. Now, the Zyra Ashe lane is really potent.
Incredible.
If you can lock down someone with an arrow and then Zyra gets a Grasping Roots into the full combo, that's a lot of damage that you could throw down to a singular target despite Karma Shield, so it is a fairly scary lane to play into.
It's also something we talked about yesterday into an Olaf. You're separating him from the rest of his team with the Stranglethorns. You can do the same with the Nautilus if he jumps in. So even with you having a Jhin on your backline here, I am a little bit worried for LDLC. With the mid lane pick, you really need someone who can get past that Stranglethorns as well. So the LeBlanc, you're looking also maybe Cassiopeia, although it's a lot harder to dodge around with that. I think LeBlanc really suits the style. And Ika, if I recall correctly, did play LeBlanc a couple of times for Elements when he was playing for them.
I wouldn't be surprised to see Orianna potentially locked in for Matislaw. I really wouldn't be surprised. I mean, he's had such good performances on
it. He's only played Orianna.
Exactly,
so
and it's very safe versus the LeBlanc. You know, if you want to pick a safe mid laner, Orianna tends to be that type of mid. So I would personally, especially with the Poppy and the Rek'Sai there, you do have that synergy that breaks out.
Yeah, and I mean, we've already seen that Matislaw can have a very good early game on Orianna. We saw on one of the games, I think it was 3-0 before things started to go a bit south for BOB. So, wouldn't be too surprised to see it, but we'll see. Hovering through a multitude of champions, so not giving us any clues in terms of that. But let's take a look at the LDLC composition now that one's already built. Where are these guys going to be going in this game?
I mean, we've seen this quite a few times. The Jhin, Olaf, it happens a lot. You open the Jhin ultimate in the bot lane. Kurtical Corki actually coming through. That's a little bit of a surprise. Does well into LeBlanc in lane, as Corki does well into most things in lane. but interesting as to where it goes from there. You get the poke and you get a lot of burst damage, I guess, to follow up on the Ash Arrow.
I think part of it as well is the ability to escape the Nautilus and Olaf as they jump onto you. You can Valkyrie away. Also, if you want to roam the map, you can catch Jin out with a supercharged Valkyrie because of the package. And there is a possibility with it. I think I would have preferred the Orianna that you were talking about. The risk with that is, though, does get melted down by the Olaf. You can't shockwave him away, and you can't really get rid of the Nautilus.
It is very susceptible to the Nautilus, like you said. Like, Orianna does deal with hard CC poorly, and you would be probably forced to take a cleanse in this situation, even though it might not be as useful in lane, only really good for the chains. Better in the later stages of the game. What Corki does give you is large amounts of mobility, especially when you have the package as well. I guess we should go back to the original question, though, about the composition, as you're smiling. It is just that combo, you know, the Jin uses Curtain Call, Olaf can run through it, capitalize off the slow of the bullets, and then you have LeBlanc to help execute targets there as well as that disruption of Nautilus. It has that one singular game plan, but we talked about that Zyra-Olaf interaction before, Sona.
Yeah. It is quite a difficult interaction to play perfectly, but I think LDLC have the ability to make the calls properly. We haven't really seen them miscommunicate too many times, unlike some of the other teams around here. So all you have to do is when the Stranglethorns comes down, you say, nope, we're backing out, run away. It's fine, you burnt your Ghost or you burnt your Ragnarok. A bad Olaf will burn both as he tries to run in, but a well-played Olaf will either Ghost in, wait for the Stranglethorns to come out, and then as his team calls the engage, say, okay, we're Ragnaroking in or we're just backing out of it. If you look on the side of Abaski, they have pretty strong lineup as well. We talked about the lane matchup with Corki LeBlanc. I worry for them slightly that their late game damage might fall off. You know, Ash needs to get consistent auto attacks down to get that damage. Zyra will build up into sort of a more AP mage later on, but you're looking at two or three items before she gets there. And Corki just has poke damage, doesn't really have the sustained damage you'd want in or the burst damage you'd want in a fight.
Yeah, I think Corki definitely one of those champions that at certain points in the game will definitely spike in burst. I'm looking at, like, classically the Triforce. I don't know whether they'll go AD or what kind of build we'll be looking at in this game, but, I mean, you might be able to shed some light on that one, Excalibur.
The Corki build. Hextech Gunblade, go a little bit more hybrid, but then you pick up the Triforce. So you see high Triforce, Hextech Gunblade, that kind of thing.
I think the thing is, because his damage is naturally split now anyway, you don't really need to worry too much about going all down AP or all down AD. So as you're saying, Trinity Force Hextech is usually
you won't see too many full AP Corkis these days, but the Hextech Gunblade is such a powerful item now that actually Corki makes good use of it. Interestingly enough, you talked about Burst of Corki. We saw in the other day, Corki could basically one-shot people, even in the later stage of the game. Zyra, one step out of position.
That's the thing, though. It's if you can get onto the backline squishies. Like, he's going to be trying to do that to an Olaf and a Nautilus.
Yeah.
Unless LeBlanc oversteps and he predicts the overstep, then he's going to be able to catch someone.
And you have the karma as well. Yeah. The one thing that Corki does have is that if the chains come down on him, he can always Valkyrie away. So he's going to be a pretty hard target for LeBlanc to lock down. I'm very interested to see how this plays. It doesn't seem like it's much of a composition that plays heavily around the Ash Arrow, though. There isn't that immediate follow-up of hard CC. Ash Arrow into Grasping Roots, maybe into Unburrow is the best that I can think of.
I think you're looking Ash Arrow into Unburrow really most of the time. Corki can Valkyrie across that. You do get a lot of damage actually from the burn as well, especially if you've got the package. So it's very much an isolate the Jim or isolate the LeBlanc, and then from that you follow up with the rest of the team fight because you have greater numbers.
Okay, so judging on this conversation, this seems like a fairly even draft phase, which, to be honest, across the course of the last few days, we've not seen that many dead even draft phases.
I think we've just
seen
very
quite
opinionated.
A lot of one-sided ones, but I want to get your predictions for this one a little bit early. We'll start with you, Sona. Where do you think we're going to be going in this game? Who do you think is going to take it?
So as we've been talking, I like both of the drafts. I think they both play to certain strengths. I like LDLC slightly more. It's a little bit more coherent to me as a composition and works well into their enemy, which means they've adapted throughout the comp. I'm going to go with LDLC. I think we've seen a little bit more from them, and I think Babaski are going to be in for a challenge.
I really love the siege that Babaski have brought forward. Corki and Ash makes for a really good siege composition. But I don't think they play well enough around the Ash Arrow to really utilize that properly, as well as the fact that Zyra can separate the Olaf team, but then obviously you don't have to play into it and play around that. I actually prefer the Babaski draft to an extent, but
there
I just
go. He says Babaski. Babaski is gone for there. Munch, let's move on to you.
I just think LDLC are the better team right now, so I'll go for LDLC.
Okay, I think I'm probably going to agree on LDLC on this one, despite the draft. I think LDLC look like one of the forerunners. And speaking of forerunners, we've been mentioning how LDLC may well end up at the top of that table. they've not really proven it so far. 1-1 so far until this game. We'll find out whether they can turn that into 2-1. How important is this game, and do you think this is playing on their minds? Do you think the fact that they've already got a loss might affect them coming into a game?
It could do. I think you give them a slight disservice saying they're 1-1 because they played Fnatic Academy and no one's beating Fnatic Academy yet.
No, much of a disservice when they are 1-1.
It's not a disservice, but you're saying it as if they haven't played well thus far. And I think over the course of two games, they've looked consistent, they've looked good, they've been slip-ups here and there, they haven't been an entirely clean team, but it might play on their mind slightly. I think this is the sort of game where they need to obviously step up. We are getting into day three. We're getting into the business end of the tournament. But I don't see them making mistakes this game. I think it's going to be pretty crisp and clean.
I think they do have pressure on them. If they lose this game, they lose all chances to get out of the group, I would argue, to be honest. Given where Babaski is and the rest. I think this will be a high-pressure game.
Well, we'll have to find out. We are going to be jumping onto Summoner's Rift for the fifth time today. Now, 5 out of 7 games. Let's head onto the field and see who is going to be able to take this match out. LDLC up against Babaski. It's going to be France up against Poland. And we'll see who's going to have the better chance at heading towards that Challenger Series. Certainly going to be an interesting one. We've already mentioned how the drafts are, fairly even, possibly even tilted toward Babaski, but we'll have to find out as the game goes on, and I think a lot of it is going to be in the hands of Nero.
Oh, definitely. A lot of it also comes down to how they play, in all honesty, how they play into their strategy, because as Excoundrel said, they've got a great siege on Babaski. You know, Zyra can zone people really well. You've got Corki rockets, you've got the arrows coming out from Ashe as well, but it doesn't look to me like Babaski have that coordination they need to be able to actually stick that down. Now, LDLC are going to sneak into this bush. They've already cleared out a ward here, which means that really Babaski knows something's going on, and they played relatively safe, which is smart from them.
So now, standard across the early game here, just going to be spreading out across the map. Obviously, we did see a tiny bit of attempted cheese almost in the bottom lane, but easily scouted out. We've seen that a couple of times across this tournament as well. People trying to get an early advantage. We certainly saw it earlier on today when it was Tricked running with the Draven. It was Critbud there pushing forward with the Leona as well. Didn't manage to find anything though except a flash. So this game, even less than that achieved.
I think something important to point to is when you look across summoner spells here, actually Ika's gone for Ignite in that lane. Does give her the kill pressure onto this Corki, especially if you can be landing those Shatter Orbs alongside Distorting in. You know, the Sigil of Manus passive allows you to push away pretty effectively, and all she's going to be looking to do is Shatter Orb auto, Shatter Orb auto, Shatter Orb auto, and get that consistent harass down onto the Corki. If this had been an Orianna, that's a little bit more difficult to do because he command protects and then just gets the harass down on you. But Ika's showing that he thinks he can win this matchup, and with the Ignite, he has the possibility of actually just smashing into Mattislaw a few times.
Yeah, we should hopefully be able to turn off chat.
Chat is not on there from our side, it's actually on the feed that we get, so we apologize for that. But as you can see, everyone has no longer got mouse problems and we are all ready to get into the game.
Which is excellent news, to be honest. We don't want anyone with the inability to click in this matchup. Certainly these teams are going to have to click when it comes down to their team compositions, all going to have to work together excellently. But so far, very standard, nothing crazy coming out from either team, and pretty much exactly what we're expecting from this one. I think my real question right now is going to be, how do you expect these two junglers to start this early game? Obviously, Tanky on the Rek'Sai, you expect to pretty much just follow. That's like standard fare. Where do you go with the Olaf? Do you do the same thing? Do you maybe look for a duel with your passive, getting extra attack speed with low HP?
So it's something we used to see Rek'Sai do. Ike is trading into Mattislaw once again. That's exactly what he needs to be doing, by the way. Nero here, he'll probably look to farm up to 4 or 5, maybe even try and get up towards that level 6 before he impacts the lanes. Where there was a short spell, really, where we saw Olaf's going for early aggressive gank paths, especially when you looked at Rainover from Immortals, he would play the Olaf and do that. However, that hasn't really been the case anymore, especially with a team prioritizing vision on the enemy jungler, trying to get those deep wards in. Really, you see the Olaf go towards that level 6. If I were going to see ganks, I'd expect them more from Tanky. He's got a bit more crowd control early on, and actually they're going to spot out Nero here as he walks into unknown.
Nari's in a lot of trouble, doesn't have Ragnarok yet, actually smites the Krug to keep himself alive. Great play from him. Unknown now could be in trouble. The dots are ticking. One more auto might have done it, but Frayed can't find him. Riptide will slow tanky. Nero and as well Ica coming up for support there to keep their teammates alive. First blood still not achieved.
It was very close though, and I also think Unknown actually slightly slow on his corrupting potion pop there, because he popped it as he was going low, but if he popped it earlier, might have got the kill. A trade in the bot lane as well.
Ignite is down. Mystiques will walk away though from this one. Crown is still very low. Pookie potentially could turn that around, but with moops around, seems unlikely.
A couple more summoners to talk about. The ignites in the bot lane, not common fare for supports these days. Usually we see exhaust, oh. But
Freight's in trouble actually. Won't be able to use his dredge line with the steadfast presence. Now flashes at the end. That was a very close
tanky.
Escape. Tanky has actually going to look
here.
For the Prey Seeker. Can he find his target? The minion wave?
Not in the right position. And Freight was just about out anyway. Mattislaw being traded into by Ico once again. That's exactly what he needs to do. Jump in, jump out, avoid the Gatling dump, gun, armor, shred, and just get the extra damage down. Interesting build here by Freight. Actually gone double Dorans in the top lane. And Pookie Star is going to get engaged on by Moops.
Yeah, Pookie, I don't think we'll last this one. Actually going to donate the kill as well to Crowny. There's first blood, but Frayed is going to be traded immediately. So junglers both heading into their respective lanes.
Chat is off now, guys.
So chat's out of the way with as well.
We hope.
But that was the first blood going to Crowny.
Yeah, that's huge. Getting the kill on the Jhin, especially since it looks to me like the LDLC actually have the push in this lane. Not 100% to be expected. Dancing Grenade does push a lane a little bit, and Karma does as well with Mandragora Flame, but Ash Zyma really should have the potential to force that lane in a little bit stronger. They seem to have been a little bit passive in that bottom lane, but now Crowny has a BF sword into just the pickaxe of Pookie Style, gives him a big damage spike, and Jhin, of course, works well when he's ahead of the enemy carry. Fade, because he went this double Dorans, was very susceptible to a gank, and they knew he'd burn his flash, so well played by Tanky to stick around top, understand that getting Unknown ahead is important, and be able to pick up that kill for his top laner, although he took the kill.
Certainly did. And there's starting to be some CS leads spreading out across the map right now. We've got a 10 CS lead in favor of Ica in the mid lane. We've got just over 10 CS lead in favor of Nero as well, as Tanky is going to head back to base. Up in the top lane, an ever so slight CS lead, but nothing too major, and it's actually closing as well as we speak. So just a little bit of gold lead around the map, but nothing exceptional, nothing that's really going to tilt the balance.
I think mid lane is really where you want to focus with that at the moment. It's about 13 up, and you can see every time Mattislaw steps forward, he just takes a huge amount of harass. He's building up towards Hexdrinker first, and he'll keep it just at the Hexdrinker. He won't go to more for a while at least when he's looking towards, you know, Hextech and towards Trinity Force. But he needs that little bit of shield. He needs to be able to keep himself a bit safer from Ica, who now level 6 as well has that Mimic available.
Well, Ica certainly, on that LeBlanc, he has to be aggressive. He has to make some things happen in this early game, because LeBlanc is the kind of champion that it becomes very difficult to have a major impact later on in the game. Nero
nice,
does secure his blue buff there, so good job by him to keep control of his own jungle.
Yeah, he really needed to get that as well. Olaf so reliant on blue early on to be able to get a good clear off of the jungle. You're spamming undertow after undertow, and actually, Tanky, because he'd got that kill, had a level advantage, which meant that his smite was ever so slightly stronger. But just the vision in the bush for Nero meant that he was able to actually get that smite down.
I just want to have a second try at saying what I was saying a second ago.
Yeah, you can do it.
I feel like the sentence I'd said was incomplete and therefore just incorrect as well.
Okay.
What I mean is LeBlanc finds it very difficult to find assassination opportunities in the late game. Not that LeBlanc is bad in the late game. She still does terrifying damage. It's just very difficult to get onto those squishy targets so long as your enemy team is playing as that unit.
Especially against a team with hard CC. Ash Arrow can always be kept to try and snipe off the LeBlanc as she jumps forward. You've always got the opportunity for the Rek'Sai just to unburrow underneath you as well, and Poppy can heroic charge you into the wall. Now, Nero, once again, we've seen this before on the Olaf, hitting 6 coming, but Ica's on his way as well.
There's no vision right here. I don't think the Hawkshot saw him.
I think it did the way they're playing. I'm pretty sure it
Heal
did.
Heal comes out, Undertow lands, but not enough to actually secure a kill.
If it didn't see them, that is one of the best predictions I have ever seen in my life. But yeah, pretty sure it just glimpsed him as he was waiting there. Now, Tanky's looking for a ganking top.
Yeah, this could be dangerous right now. That is going to be a double knock on Freyd, bouncing up and down, but he gets a kill. Managing to trade that one. Tanky actually almost goes down as well to the cannon minion. Will survive, though, in the end. That would have been huge if Freyd got two.
It would have been absolutely massive. He did get the double knock-off from his depth charge, but wasn't quite able to pick up the kill. Part of that as well as double Dormans giving him that extra AP.
Yeah, it will obviously increase his damage, especially the damage over time on his Titan's Wrath, as well as the Riptide. Pookie in trouble here. There's the Ragnarok. Nair actually backs out again, as we do have a teleport from Freyd. Looks like they want to donate this double kill to Freyd. The anchor comes down straight onto the head of Pookie, and now Matislaw could be in a little bit of trouble, but looks like Tanky has arrived to back up his mid laner. Ika goes down. Nice little assassination there coming out from Matislaw.
That's what Matislaw can do on this Corki. You chase him with a package, you get the extra damage down. Now he's got Hexdrinker, he's not taking as much damage from that LeBlanc, and it actually feels like Ika had delayed going back for a long time there, because he was only sitting on a Lost Chapter, now has the Sorcerer's Shoes as well, alongside the Amplifying Tome. Should have gone back a lot sooner, because Matislaw had picked up his item Spike, and Ika was missing his own.
Certainly was, and now Ika kind of feeling the wrath of that Corki pick, and he's lost a significant chunk of the CS lead that he did have. However, Crowny has more than made up for that, because when you look down to the bottom lane, there is a 30 CS lead as well as a kill and an assist. Crowny is soaring ahead of his opponent.
Alongside that, they managed to pick up the bottom lane tower in that push, which is huge. First brick has been so impactful amongst these games. I'd like to actually see a stat at the end of it to see what the percentage is for the win after you get that first brick, because it seems to be at least 60 or 70% of the time. And now we're going to see LDLC come up towards this top lane pretty soon, you have to expect. It seems to be what you do. However, at the moment, Crowny and Moops are sitting down towards bottom lane, mostly because there's an elemental dragon to be claimed, and it is an Infernal.
That is a huge pickup for LDLC. Not only do they have a just under 3,000 gold lead for themselves, they've also got that 6% AD and AP bonus. That is a huge pickup. They're going to be very happy to stroll on up towards the top side of the map, maybe towards mid lane, and start to look for more towers, start to inflict that damage upon their opponents.
It may not seem like much, you know, that you just say, oh, they just picked up one dragon, but Infernal is a colossal advantage to have, especially in the early game. Amplifying that AD, amplifying that AP. You've got a Jhin, you've got a LeBlanc, even Nautilus does a huge amount of work. Massive amounts of damage will be coming out from this LDLC team now, and they're looking up towards top lane for that tower.
I've got to say, Infernal has definitely felt like the rarest dragon in this tournament.
We've had really a couple of games where we've had two of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, like, we've seen a lot of Cloud and a huge amount of Ocean Drake with a spattering of Mountain as well.
I'm wondering if that's confirmation bias, though, because sometimes it does. And also, you have to remember, when you see a Cloud Drake on the map, it's very rarely taken quickly. So it can sit there for a while, and you don't actually see any other Drake spawn for the game. So it's a little bit of a catch-22 when you say you see a lot of Cloud, but I agree with you. It feels like at points we have had a very windy week here in Leicester with the amount of Cloud Drakes that have spawned on Summoner's Rift.
Unknown getting engaged upon here by Freyd once again. This matchup, you're not really expecting too much to come of it in a one versus one. I've got to say, I think it's actually Ocean that we've seen the most of. I think I just seem to remember seeing thousands and thousands of Ocean Drakes across these games, but regardless, here we go. 2,000 gold lead now with a tower and a dragon. LDLC are sitting pretty. However, it's only 12 minutes into the game. The 2,000 gold lead, or yeah, 2,000 gold, it's not massive. It's not enough to just win the game on its own. They still need to push this advantage and find other ways to abuse their lead. Jhin almost with an infinity edge down in the bottom lane. I wouldn't be surprised to see them wait to finish that item and then try and push.
Definitely. I think they can probably set up a little bit of a siege, especially with the Curse and Call, which has been used.
Yeah, Mystiques is in a lot of trouble. He's already dead. In fact, Nero traded one for one, though, so an even trade, and Babaski, they're going to be happy with that one, because that might just be enough to protect their tower. Matislaw coming on up as well to make sure that his AD carry has the support required, since Mystiques is no longer on the map. Has been caught out by two chains on this one.
How many was that, sir?
Two chains.
Two whole chains, okay. I think there's a thing with Olaf that you always have to be careful of and wary of. You know, you're ulting in and you sometimes you forget that things actually do damage to you. So he runs straight into a Stranglethorn. Stranglethorns obviously does damage. And also Ragnarok is actually removing some of the passive stats you get as Olaf. You're taking away some bonus armor, some bonus magic resist. I think what level is he at the moment? He's level 8, so that's about 20 extra armor and magic resist that you've removed from yourself going in with the Ragnarok. And it makes you a lot squishier than you expect to be. So Nero there, playing a little bit overly aggressive. It's great to try and get the kill. Taking out Mystiques is vital if you're going to dive a tower because of the Stranglethorns, but you can't lose your life in the process. Otherwise, the hold is a little bit too easy for Babaski.
Well, now Tanky going to run in. Nero does manage to grab his wolf. That's the second time he's kept his jungle alive, but he's not keeping himself alive on this one. Matislaw has been caught though. The CC chain is actually huge here. The Maw or Hexdrink are gonna keep him alive for a second, but not long enough. There's a kill coming through. Tanky's gonna drop as well. Double kill comes through for Ika. Make that a triple. Ika, king of the early game right now, as Unknown finally trades one. Gets Crowny down, but will he actually be able to survive here? There's gonna be a lot of CC about to land on him. The first chain locks him up. Then we're gonna see Nautilus passive as well on top of everything else. Still half of his HP remaining, but it'll be slowly but surely chipped away here. And Ika with the unofficial quadra kill, and he's suddenly miles ahead.
What a tremendous fight for LDLC. It looked originally like Babaski had caught out Nero. Tanky and Matislaw able to get in there, and then it took such a long time to kill Matislaw as well. I was pretty sure LDLC would only get one or two kills out of it. Immediately, Ika just dancing around the fight. We saw Frayd coming in from the top side to lock off any possibility of a retreat. They get four kills on their LeBlanc and they get a tower.
And Nero having to Ragnarok though still goes down. Frayd will be able to flash himself to safety though. So they lose another tower. It's two towers down for Babaski now, but at least they managed to get a kill. Pookie though will be another kill if we could just find one more ability. He's on about 2 HP. Moops is not looking to let him get away.
Dodge.
Predicts the Duke and finishes him off.
There was a Reddit thread a couple of days ago where Thresh hooks were being predicted because people dodge away from the turret thinking that you're going to chuck that Q at the tower.
Sensei Aframu teaching everyone.
Exactly. 200 IQ Q there as they did manage to pick up a kill with the Inner Flame. LDLC, 10 kills to 7 up now. I've spread that lead to about 4,000. And the general rule that I apply and that a lot of people apply is if it's more than 10%, it's a significant gold lead. At the moment, we're looking at about a 30% lead here for LDLC. That is substantial enough, especially when a lot of it's on LeBlanc.
Yeah, Ika did just use his jump there, but Tanky not going to be able to get on top. Not very tanky at all, in fact, as Ika jumps in. He's looking for a little bit more damage. And with Moops coming on down, Crowny on top of everything else, the Roots, look how much lockdown there is on this team. Every single time they find someone, there is no escape.
Ethereal chains alongside the chains coming out from Karma and the Deadly Flourish and the Nautilus. It's just so much CC to have to deal with. And it's something we talked about previously as well. It's so easy for LDLC to lock someone down. Scoundrel was saying in Pick and Ban he thought perhaps Babaski had it because of their siege potential. And I agree. They have great siege potential, but we have not seen them siege.
Yeah.
Because they're behind, because they fear Ika, because they fear the narrow flank, because they fear Frayd teleporting in, and Crowny's caught out.
Goodbye, Crowny, I think is the only play-by-play I can go with in that situation. I've got to say, one thing we've not really spoken about is the fact that Tanky is actually getting pretty far ahead. He's got 5 kills for himself, 2 deaths and 1 assist. So significantly ahead of Nero in this situation. But that's not very good in terms of where the gold is
exactly.
On Babaski. Rek'Sai isn't going to hard carry.
It's something we've seen time and time again throughout the tournament. You know, Lee Sin's getting 5 kills. Support's getting 3 kills. It's just all over the place sometimes, and you need to prioritize where that gold goes. Now, Ika's actually jumping in.
Wow, the damage out of Ika. Just picks up Pookie immediately. To be honest, I thought Ika was just going to have to bail on that one, and well, he might have to because Tanky's arrived on the scene, and that kill is actually going to be donated in the end to Mystiques. I think Tanky realizing that he's got plenty of gold for himself, he needs to share the love just a little bit. Moops heading up towards this top lane. I think he needs to be careful quite how aggressively he pushes this one. We'll be able to scare them off though, as we've got Nero coming on through the jungle on top of Crowny in the lane. And that will be enough to deter Babaski. All that they needed to do was to just deter them from the team.
And they've done that well. They're going to hook in Mystiques.
Goodbye, Mystiques. These have been incredibly quick kills. Every single time one of the players gets caught on either side, they're gone in seconds.
Both teams are burst focused at the moment as well. We talked about the Corki having that phosphorus bomb, having those missiles to chuck in as well. Ash, pretty quick burst for an AD carry as well with the Ranger's focus. Jhin especially quick. And then, of course, LeBlanc is known as that burst assassin who can just jump in. So LDLC at the moment have the advantage in the fact that they're pushing and a lot of their kills are sitting on the right targets, as you said. But there's always a possibility that Babaski can continue to set up these plays where they catch out a member of LDLC and get themselves back into this game.
Yeah, but now 3-1. LDLC, storming ahead. Two dragons for themselves as well. I believe that was a Infernal Drake as well as an Ocean Drake for LDLC. They're going to be very happy with the lead that they've managed to accrue for themselves. But this is the point in the game that we've seen some teams struggle. And this is the point in the game where when Babaski were ahead in their first game, they started to struggle. They had the three towers, but the question was, where do we go from here? How do we continue to extend the lead?
It's all about taking that second ring, basically. The tier two towers are the hardest to take, apart from inhibitor towers, of course. So I guess they're only the second hardest to take. But really being able to get into the enemy and behind them is the difficulty, because there's such a small gap of jungle where you can really look for the flank, and the enemy team has this vast swathe of jungle in which they can start to position and try and get vision control around you, especially when you're looking at people like a Corki who's got the package, you're looking at the Rek'Sai who can burrow and unburrow around. LDLC, they have the advantage in the gold, and they're far enough ahead that they can, just if they want, try and force a tower, try and force an objective, but they're always going to be wary of the fact that Babaski can get those flanks off and can try and reposition around them.
See how the positioning is going to be throughout this game. But LDLC certainly starting to put some deeper vision in now. We've seen that now that the tier 1 towers have gone down, they've started to push their ward line forward. Moves caught out a little bit narrow, going to be caught by the crystalline arrow, but not too big of an issue for him. He's got support with him, so he'll stay alive. I like that use of the mimic there. Ica sending his clone in just to try and bait out some abilities.
Underappreciated, in all honesty. I mean, that was a little bit obvious because it ran straight underneath the turret, but the ability just to make people apprehensive by having that mimic come in is important. Curtain Call used here on Babaski.
Last shot doesn't quite land, though. The crit isn't going to connect to its target, but here we go. Ica on the back line trying to find a target. Has to jump away again.
But look at that. Immediately, Mystiques has to flash. As soon as that Shatter Orb comes down, he knows any other skill connecting is just pure death and destruction.
Yeah. And this is what I was talking about as well. When we get to these situations where the teams are grouped up, it's much more difficult for Ica to really successfully get a target down. Freight now in a bit of trouble. 2-1. He is one very, very tanky diver.
He's not as tanky as he could be, though. If you look at it, you know, he's got double Dorans. We're going to see Nero join the fight.
Yeah, Nero will jump on in, and he's looking to Nero just, like, jumps in, tries to save his teammate, goes like, actually, I'm not sure this is going to go too well.
Drive by
I will
Olaf.
See you later, Nautilus. I'm out of here.
That was amazing. It's just like, Nero's like, oh, no. Okay, yeah, I immediately regret this decision. Have fun, Nautilus. Definitely weighing down his team there, Freyd. It's the double Dorans to some degree as well. You know, you delay your build by quite a bit. It's 800 gold you're investing that could be invested into getting that Spirit Visage ever so slightly earlier. Now has that, so he'll be a little bit more tanky. I still feel, because the Rek'Sai is so fed, you know, tanky has those four kills and unknown is in a strong position on the Poppy. It's going to be difficult for Freyd for a while to trade into that 2v2. And the problem for him was that LDLC weren't really in a position on the rest of the map to get anything off it. So if they delayed for that long, it's just like, okay, two of their members are somewhere else. We four-man engage into a three-man underneath a tower. We get the tower and we get an easy couple of kills as well. But Babaski had played it perfectly timed, really, to set that up.
Oh Crowdy flashes into the crystalline arrow. He's going to get locked up against the wall by Unknown. Fantastic news for Babaski. Two kills straight off the back of that mistake. Unfortunately, no Drake available for them to immediately capture, but they can head towards his mid lane.
That they can. Crowny, it's not the direction you want to flash. Nero also taken out in that fight as well. So two members down here for LDLC. Ika does have vision control here with the control ward and can just pop someone down.
Ika will be found out by Tanky, though. To be honest, with Tanky's scoreline, 10 out of the 12 kills have had him involved. I don't think that's the target that he wants to be trying to burst down. He's going to get, pardon the pun, Tanky in this situation. But one thing I do want to point out is the differential in between AD carries right now, because we've got a 50 CS lead almost in between the AD carries, as well as two kills. And you can see that in the items. Both of them have boots, but we've got two items complete on either side with another half an item in the hands of Crown. He's already got that Caulfield's Warhammer, and he's not been back in quite a while.
Now we'll be looking to finish that up pretty soon as well. Ocean Drake, not the biggest objective here for LDLC. They want to try and smite it away if they can.
Yeah. Do manage to grab it, but here comes the curtain call. Mystiques will be finished off. The snipe comes through from Crowny. Ika stuck between a rock and a hard place there. Went in a little bit too deep. Pookie somehow survives on about a half an HP. DFG comes on through, or Deathfire Touch, sorry, and there's the double kill for Crowny. Looking for a known now, who's tanky, but not that tanky when you've got a Jhin barreling down on you, getting those crits. Has to flash away in the end. Deathfire Touch again, you see it ticking away there. Will walk away though.
LDLC unable to pick up the Drake, but they do get two kills, which means they should be able to get mid lane tower off this push as well, although the Rek'Sai's on his way to try and defend. There's a package as well, actually, for Mattislaw, so he might be able to play. Something foul is in the air as Tanky goes behind them with the Void Rush, and Teleport comes in from Unknown.
Yeah, we're looking for flanks here, and it's going to be LDLC trying to escape. The package comes on through, and Crowny is obliterated. Mattislaw, though, in a 2v1, has to flash, but will get locked up by Frayed. Nice charge from Unknown to keep his AD carry alive, or his mid laner, in fact. Nero now trying to escape from Tanky. Will smite the Skull Crab just for a little bit of extra
HP. Oh, the dodge.
Nice little juke. Dodges away from the knockup, but walks straight on into Mattislaw's Gatling gun.
There is an argument here for Babaski actually to turn straight towards the Baron. You've got rid of the jungler, you've got rid of Crowny as well, who's one of the long-range threats. However, Ika's still alive, means they'll probably just go up towards the top lane tower.
Yeah, the top lane tower should be relatively easy to take down. They've got a big minion wave there already. They're all in the correct position. I think the Baron, while it looks tempting, that's definitely a solo queue kind of Baron, I think, where you go for it and then everything just goes pear-shaped.
We've seen a few of those in this tournament as well.
Yes, we
so
have.
Not just confined to solo queue. Next time your team throws there, remember the professionals do it too. It's something that's ubiquitous throughout League of Legends. Ika, you saw actually in that dragon fight, I just want to go all the way back to that, where they were fighting around the Ocean Drake. Ika has there's a very large risk for him when he jumps into a fight like that. When he gets right into the back line, he's going to get caught out by the heroic charge, especially if he's around terrain, especially if the Rek'Sai's there as well to knock him up with the Umbrella, or there's an Ash Enchanted Crystal Arrow. Ika is going to be their main target. Now, Crowny did a lot of work in the fight, but if Crowny's not close enough, or if he's somehow isolated away by Mattislaw, Ika needs to be incredibly cautious as to how he actually engages, because if he's going in solo and these crowd control spells have not been used previously, he's just going to get locked up and taken down.
And that's a situation that just cannot afford to occur. That is the situation that immediately loses you the fight, immediately loses you more objectives. But Babaski have closed this gold gap very significantly. Only 2,500 difference now. Unknown Afraid once again at it, yet neither of them able to battle through a shield just yet. Legend says they're still trying to get through those shields.
Yeah. One of them will lose some HP at some point, I'm sure, but yeah. I don't think it's going to stay lost for long either. Iceborne Gauntlet is the next item on both of those top lane carries, I guess you could call them, and that really won't affect their fighting potential against each other too much at all. Nautilus gets a little bit more crowd control, which is great for him, Poppy as well, but both of them are looking at joining the team fight. If one of them can cancel the other's teleport,
yep,
that is incredibly impactful, but these teams have shown us they're high enough caliber not to put themselves in that sort of position.
Yeah, and that Iceborne Gauntlet as well. Just a nice little bit of extra wave clear. Nothing game-changing, but every little helps, especially when your biggest wave clear is going to be your Sunfire Cape. You want that extra. It's almost like a bonus tick of your Sunfire Cape.
I mean, you look at it, Fayd should push the Poppy in still, because even with Sunfire Cape, she doesn't actually clear the wave incredibly quickly. She's using Hammer Smash to do it, and that kind of relies on you grouping the minions up to some degree. And he's got Riptide, so he should be able just to stand in that minion wave, Riptide it, and it dies, basically. Especially if he's been maxing that, which a lot of Nautiluses do in lane. They're going to take the turret.
I think it's Nautili.
Would it be Nautili? Nautilus would be from I want to say
No, I don't think it would be Nautilai.
I think it might be, actually.
Oh, wait, it's US, like Cactus, so yeah. Nautilai.
I think it would be Nautilai.
There you go.
Good, thing there's only one, a unique Nautilus for us on the Summoner's Rift. Nautilus actually named after the submarine in the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
I did not know that.
Anyway, we're going to see Ink.
There we go.
Jump away here by Tanky Cat to flash the chains.
There we go, Pookie, half HP already. Tanky on the front line, having to back away towards the rest of his team. Triple knock up from the Death Charge there. Frayed having a good time of it. Tower still remains on a lot of HP. Tanky going to be heading back to base, but will have that Void Rush available. Unknown now. Trying to get rotating on up towards this top lane, trying to support the rest of his team and maybe look for an after engage. But here we go. Tanky on the back line. He's managed to get that Void Rush over towards Ika, but I don't think he's going to be able to really achieve too much in this one. Actually, does get chained up by the Ethereal Chains from Ika, but no follow-up and nothing comes of it in the end.
Whatsoever. Really, you saw it was an attempted engage by LDLC. They were looking for the fight, and you've looked across to me, and I'm actually looking up to make sure I got that Nautilus thing right, because I think it's something to do with Captain Nero, and I might be incorrect, and I don't want to be incorrect on stream. No, there we are. Yep, get in from 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
Good stuff.
I knew something at some point.
The midstream fact check.
You gotta make sure you're getting these things correct. The amount of time, we get caught up on these things. Production comes up to us afterwards and says, you wouldn't win at Trivial Pursuits, you can't win when you're casting, you have to get these things right. But coming back to the game, Babaski actually, as you said, have evened out this gold lead quite a bit. Only 3,000 gold, the difference between the two teams. Now, there is still an Infernal Drake on LDLC, which will give them an advantage in the fight. They do still have Ika, who's at 5 kills, but that Cork is looking pretty darn delicious to fight against at the moment with the Hextech Gunblade and the Trinity Force alongside that Hex Drinker. He's going to be building up a little bit more in just a minute, and it's a second ocean here for Babaski as LDLC look to fight.
Yeah, Kurt Cole once again. Every single fight we see this right at the start. It's the way to kick things off for the likes of LDLC. Dragon down to half HP. Tanky is going to be hit as well as Nero. They're going to be in a smite war on this one. Tanky manages to get it in the end. Ika in the back line trying to do as much damage as he can. One goes down. There's a second for Crowny. Tanky not tanky enough on this one. Unknown will get chained up as well as a double kill comes through for Crowny on the Djinn. And that will be... I mean, what objective do they even go
Baron.
For here?
They ping Baron straight away. This is the smart objective for them. They've taken out the enemy jungler. They've taken out the AD carry and the mid laner as well. There's not really any burst potential left on Babaski. They can take this Baron incredibly quickly, and they will just be able to do it very easily here. I want to bring attention to Ika in that fight. Superb flank position. He jumped behind into the blue area of that red side jungle, onto the backline carries, jumped away, escaped, distracted the whole team. They all turned around to try and face him. You even see Unknown jumping onto him with the charge as well, and they still weren't able to take him down. He did an amazing job, and the Baron will go over to LDLC.
Yeah, valiant effort there by Mystiques to try and
if he'd stolen
steal
it with
that
the grasping roots, that would have just...
That would have been glorious, but unfortunately not going to be the case. Also, got to point out Leandri's been picked up here by Mystique, so fairly aggressive build, wanting to make sure that not just is he a support, but also in these team fights, he's going to do significant damage.
Oh, definitely. It's something we see quite commonly from Zyra's, especially when you've got an Olaf running in. You want that Stranglethorns to do as much damage as possible, so getting the Leandri's over Rylai's makes sense. You don't really care about Rylai's when you're playing into an Olaf and a Nautilus. If they're on your face, you're not going to be able to stop them from, you know, sticking onto you. So. I like that Leandri's. I want to also bring attention to Ika having Leandri's as one of his first completed items as well. Really allowing this LeBlanc to work as a tank buster as well as an assassin on that backline. So even if he's jumping onto the Poppy or onto the Rek'Sai, he's still doing a lot of work.
Yeah, and also with the Negatron Cloak, you'd assume that might well go towards an Abyssal Scepter. So even more kind of anti-magic resist in the build.
I agree with you. I think a lot of mid laners are just getting a Negatron Cloak just as an item these days. I would expect him probably go towards Rabadon's next instead, or even possibly a Zhonya's, although I think Rabadon's probably suits him a little bit more, doesn't need the Zhonya's for the escape. And this is just a harassment curse and call. As you say, LDLC have opened up a lot of their fights with it, but here, because they've got Baron-empowered minions, they know they can force Babaski back and take the tower basically for free.
Yeah, and speaking of towers, they're going to be grabbing two simultaneously. One at the top lane secured by the Curtain Call, one in the bottom lane secured by Force of Anchor. And now Aika in the mid lane. This triple pressure coming on down, and there seems to be nothing Babaski can do about it.
Split push pressure with the LeBlanc is incredibly large. Even without that teleport, which we've seen other LeBlancs take throughout the tournament, they still have a huge amount of ability just to push the waves. Nautilus does the same in the bottom lane, and now you have the three-man stack up towards the top side. Babaski need to make a call quickly.
Yeah, I think this is the best 1-3-1 pressure we've seen in the tournament so far. We've yet to see a team really utilize the Baron like this and force all three lanes simultaneously, and Babaski, they don't know what to do about it.
Part of the reason they can do this, of course, is the LeBlanc, who's just able to jump so far around the map so quickly. Look at that. Doesn't matter if two people focus her. If that was a Syndra, she'd be dead. The LeBlanc escapes quickly, double distorts away, and now we see the mid lane tower falling. Still Fade pushing in the bottom lane. Mantra'd Inspire heal by LDLC, just trying to get that last eek of damage down, and they get it with just the minions.
Yeah, this is going to be yet another curtain call. Not a very long cooldown on that one. Just ends up being used to clear away minion waves at this rate, but Aika going to return to this mid lane once more to continue hammering the pressure.
Actually used Redemption there just to top everyone up, which means that Aika is back to full HP. It's a huge thing if Pookie Style actually caught out. LDLC decide not to engage, but here comes Mantis Law.
Mantis Law's engaging. Crowny goes down already. Great stuff by Babaski. They've kept their inhibitors alive at least for now. Can they emulate that across all of the lanes, though? Two towers have already gone down. Fraser looking for a third.
That he is, and it's going to be the third inhibitor tower if he gets it. Unknown says, oh no, you don't. Knocks it right away. But the Baron empowered minions are still there, and Fade might just tank up the tower for a moment. He doesn't really care that much. Fade takes it down. All three inhibitor towers have fallen. I just want to take back something I said in Pick and Ban. I said that I didn't really see Babaski having enough burst potential. Well, Mattis Law's proved me wrong there. He's bursting people out, especially Crowny and Aika, pretty quickly. I still don't think they have enough to take out Aika if he's dodging around the fight, but he is able to pick up Crowny, and he's done a very good job of getting onto that backline with the package.
He absolutely has, and gotta say, this has been a closer game than maybe some people at home were expecting on this one. LDLC, while they are ahead, they have put a lot of pressure on these lanes. They haven't actually taken an inhibitor just yet. And I don't want to kind of overhype a situation. You know, LDLC are very far ahead. LDLC are in a phenomenal position. However, Babaski aren't out of the running just yet. And if they could force engages like had they forced that engage just a little bit sooner, they maybe could have actually defended some of those towers.
And it looks like they're getting a ZZ Rot soon as well onto Unknown. Fade has actually gone towards a redemption of his own. So there's double redemption on the side of LDLC, which to me screams of inability to be killed by the enemy team. Pookie Tile caught out here by the Curtain Call.
Oh, almost all four hit, but Mystique's tanks the last shot, and Nero immediately finishes him off. Pookie now will be finished off by Aika, and that is that damage we've been talking about from the LeBlanc. Chains don't quite connect onto Tanky, who walks away, but this is going to be the first inhibitor of the game. This spells disaster for Babaski, because DLC have already finished all of the inhibitor towers.
I feel like it's the first of three just on this push, in all honesty. LDLC can just go around each one. They've already got the towers down, and it's very difficult for Babaski to find any way to defend this. Fade doesn't care. He's just going to stand there as the front line, do whatever he wants to Babaski, and allow LDLC just to take the final inhibitor of this push.
Yeah, I like this from LDLC. They kind of semi-commit to that fight there just to force those three members away, but they don't actually want to fight. They're just kind of almost flexing their muscles. They're just intimidating Babaski so that they can finish off the inhibitor and then leave the base entirely. Now they can head towards an Elder Drake that's just spawned.
All hope lies on Bob, on Tanky at the moment, as he tries to look for this Elder Drake steal, but LDLC aren't even going to start it. They're just looking for the fight.
Hook doesn't quite land to start with. Unknown and Tanky both able to soak up a lot of damage for the rest of the team. Redemption is going to do a cheeky bit of damage to them, but nothing Aika. Crazy. Aika on the sidelines here, looking for an opportunity to get in, but this is what I was talking about. It's hard. Crowny, though, is on this front line, and he's beaten through the tanks. There's a double kill for the Djinn. He's looking for a third as well. It's going to go the way of Moops. Unknown now. He's Tanky. He will be able to run away with his life off the back of a flash, but Aika is not looking to let him walk away for free. Ignite doesn't quite finish him off. And we are going to see now LDLC will be finishing off these Nexus towers. And I don't think there's anything that these two Babaski members can do about it. This is going to be the game going the way of our French team of LDLC.
LDLC just able to close it out there. Aika's positioning in those fights was absolutely beautiful. perfectly placing himself to distract Babaski from the rest of the squad, and it allowed Crowney just to wail away time and time again on that front line, which eventually wore them down and meant that we started to see people get caught out.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Excoundrel, talk us through kind of what you saw in that game. Are there any points that we've missed that are super in-depth analysis for us?
No, I mean, you guys kind of covered the majority. There was some really good split push pressure. Like you said, some of the first time we've really seen Baron used to the maximum effectiveness. That Nautilus came in huge in terms of isolating targets. I mean, when you've got a Corki, although, you know, he can get away from the LeBlanc, there's only so many times you can Valkyrie away from the kind of input that the Nautilus can have and things like that. And that tower dive potential that they bring with the Olaf, the Jin ultimate, all of that kind of stuff, it really synergized really nicely together for Babaski. And I've got to say, Ika played a stormer of a game, really. I really was impressed with his LeBlanc there. We haven't seen too many LeBlancs really find that crucial assassin-type role that we've needed them to, and Ika, I think, did a really good job.
Yeah, and I think one of the important things there is, we mentioned it in Champion Select, how LeBlanc later on in the game, or it was actually partway through the game I mentioned it, later on in the game, it's difficult to find targets. Ika still found his ways. He was roaming around searching for flanks that he could find to just finish off those kills and make an impact in the game. Don't forget as well, guys, to go and thank our sponsors. We've got Alienware, who have been helping us out. You can go and grab yourself a brand new PC. I believe there are a few on sale if you head over to esl.pm/Alienware. And we also have a giveaway going on right now. You can win yourself a 24-inch 165Hz monitor if you head over to esl.pm/AOC. So definitely get involved. We're going to be going for a quick break, but do not go anywhere, because we have the sixth game of the night. There are going to be seven tonight, because we have the rematch of the first, or the last game of the first day.
It's actually been a long day. It's actually been a long day, but it's two alternate attacks games in a row, right?
Alternate attacks versus Forge, then alternate attacks versus Team Kinguin. Do not go anywhere. We'll be back in just a few minutes.